We're going to keep the intros very short. Pete, Brian, David, Bhush, come on up.
Storytelling. That's why we're all here, right? Just to understand that it means so much more than facts. It's the emotion. And one of the biggest things for us is the adventure. And I mean, it says it. You saw it in the film. And I actually have the first email that started the entire journey for us, Rivian, from my friend David here. I won't read it to you. That's long and boring. But what I want everyone to understand is if we go back to the date there, February of 2019, that was 3 months after we showed the first Rivians at the LA Auto Show. David, what inspired you to write this email and reach out? What was going through your head when this happened?
Little story. When you're making TV series or films, you really never know if they're going to happen. And we had made the first one, you and Charlie, Russ, the other fellow you saw up there, and myself in 2003. And then we did another one in 2008. We didn't do one for a long time after that. And we got approached by Apple. And they said, hey, we're building this service. It's going to compete with Netflix. Would you like to do another trip? So we had several conversations back and forth, and you never really know. They're interested, they love it, and one day they love us, one day they don't. They said to us, well, we're excited to do another trip, but how are you going to do it differently this time? And I was like, well, you know, people kind of like what we do, just let us do it, but we're thinking about electric vehicles. And then we just continued the conversation. Then we didn't hear from them for 3 months, and then we got an email that said, please come to Cupertino, you're one of the 25 series. So a couple minutes in, they're like, well, you really need to meet Tim Cook. So Ewan and I walk up, we go to meet Mr. Tim Cook, and Tim says, we're really excited about the series, and we hear you're going on electric vehicles. That's going to be awesome. So Ewan looked at me like, we're going on electric vehicles? Of course, they didn't exist at the time. There wasn't a motorcycle to do it. There really certainly wasn't a pickup truck. And I wrote that email in the bathroom at Apple. I was sitting there.
Like, that's why I cannot.
Shit, we're not getting this series quickly. Unless I get a couple of trucks. So, hello, Team Rivian. So, that was it.
I have RJ's response too. There you go.
A bit more laconic. Yeah.
The real email. So, several days later, RJ reaches back out, and you know, Rivian, we just shown our cars to the world. We were really excited about the product, and now we have this commitment from our CEO, Bhushan. He's sitting right in front of you. What was your take?
It was a roller coaster of an emotion. Like, first of all, like, what are we doing? To like, hey, why am I surprised? Like, what else can we expect? You saw the one-liner answer. Like, yeah, we had to do it. To a realization, hold it, we don't have a car. are we going to do
this? It wasn't
one
car that we needed, right?
We needed two cars. So we started building it, and as far as I remember, we were building it till the time we were shipping it.
We built it after it got there too. Pete, you also, I believe your first day was building these. How was onboarding?
My onboarding with Rivian was pretty unique. I guess usually you are there deciding whether you pay for the phone or the company pays for it, sign your healthcare papers and so forth. The brief was, this workshop full of parts needs to be built into two cars, put on 747, shipped to the tip of South America, and that's the brief. And from that moment on, that was, you know, that momentum was, you know, I'm here 4 years later now, and that momentum has followed us through.
It's really interesting if you think about the adventure side. But we got cars there. We got two vehicles, the first two, 001 and 002, down to Ushuaia. Before I ask you about Ushuaia on the trip, what was your favorite feature of your vehicle? What did you like the best about it?
Was it the horn that I was able to?
I love the knee horn. That was the knee horn.
No, that was the best place to put the horn.
So for anyone that doesn't know, as we built this center console and it was all the wiring coming in at the last minute, the horn ended up right near his knee. And so every time he moved his leg, he would honk. And everyone would be like, David, what's going on? He's like, sorry.
You're ruining the shot. You're honking in the shot.
Favorite feature? Yeah, other than the horn.
Gear tunnel, come on. I mean, all we had was gear. I mean, imagine if you sit there and you think about what we were trying to do and pulling cameras out and doing what we did, the gear tunnel. And then I also had a red button that nobody else has, which I think, you know, that vehicle over there is super cool, but it doesn't have a red button that actually just brings everything to stop, which was an emergency red button, which, I mean, in truth, we never used except for the time a walkie-talkie and camera fell on it.
Yeah, but that wasn't the worst walkie-talkie incident.
Wow, that's how we started. That was our first day.
Well, no, we actually couldn't start. It was too icy for the motorcycles. So Bhushan and I did a bunch of test drives because we built the charging infrastructure, but every single charger was commissioned by us showing up at it and finding out if it worked or not. So there's Pete. Pete, when was this?
This is actually Christmas time last year. I was down in the middle of Peru for my brother's wedding, actually. And I called up Brian and said, hey, I'm sure we had some charging infrastructure in this part of the world. Sure enough, I walked 500 meters, found these still wired up next to the shopping center. So, you know, the charging infrastructure still lives there today. So I was pretty stoked to see that.
That's awesome.
Well, we're fooling around, but it's worth saying. I met RJ and I pitched for 5 minutes what we were trying to do. And again, people who know RJ, people who don't know RJ will know it. 20 minutes in, he knew my project or what we were pitching better than I did. That's for sure. Number two, somebody said, well, where are they going to charge the vehicles? And RJ looked at him like James Bond. I'm not kidding. He's like, we're going to build a charging network. I was like, okay, this is my guy. We're doing this. I'm done. No more questions. I don't care what color. Let's do this.
So we build the vehicles. We get them down to Ushuaia, which... two vehicles on a 747 out of Chicago to Buenos Aires. Then you unpack them from a crate at a warehouse that, remember the place we were working on?
Yeah, so in Ushuaia, like the guy gave the keys to his warehouse and said like, hey, work on your car. And we are like, we are in this place where we don't know who the people, and the people were so welcoming. It's like, hey, you're trying to do an adventure? Here, take the keys.
But everybody, and the big thing you experience, I know, David, you've seen this in the places you've traveled doing these. It's amazing how warm and how we are all a part of this same planet. We're all in this together. And that's part of where the storytelling really captures. And as we journeyed up, we went from Argentina to Chile, back to Argentina, back to Chile, up through the Andes, all kinds of mountain passes. I know we've got a short little video because at one point in the trip, there was a week off from filming. And so we did the most Rivian thing you could possibly do during that week off. We took advantage of it and drove the vehicle some more. So if we have a quick film to cut into. We don't need no stinking phone calls. We got work to do. We got an email. We want two electric vehicles to film this amazing series, Long Way Up. We want you to be a part of it.
What are we up to? 6,600, there we go. So yeah, and we've got about that to go again. It's gonna be still quite the adventure. I can't really predict exactly what we're gonna face because that is the great unknown.
This incredible journey from South America up to LA.
I am so excited that they have license plate and they are on public roads. It's win number one, the first car which is truly registered for Rivian.
We built this vehicle to get some early durability testing. It looks and feels somewhat like production, but is very early and somewhat prototypey. When you give it full throttle, it is like 4 seconds to 80.
In the production vehicle, we'll have more power and more torque to go even faster.
100 days of driving, 13 countries, 13,000 miles, wide open spaces. There are a bunch of wild horses. We just pulled up next to them, and it's a completely silent vehicle just sitting there idling. But there's no idle because you're an electric vehicle. One of the biggest challenges is charging. We built out a charging network throughout this route of South and Central America so you can do this. We're really happy to be showing people that you can have an adventure in some of the most remote places imaginable.
Wow.
This place is amazing.
The testing is going really well. We're getting lots of data to understand what's happening, specifically with the battery, suspension, and chassis components. How can we get the car to act and react better?
We've taken all of that data, we put it in the vehicles that we're going to have out to customers next year.
I mean, we're all familiar with a lot of electric vehicles on the road today, but there is nothing sort of doing what this vehicle is embarking on right now.
We've got sand, we've got rock, these washboard roads, constant go, 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 go for, you know, 90 plus miles.
It's all going to create a better product at the end of the day, because this is a pretty epic adventure, and if they can get through this, I think they'll get through pretty much anything.
I don't know, the fact that we're out here getting to do this and show the vehicles are capable, it's a pretty sweet day at the office.
Wow.
So that's what we did with our week off of downtime. We drove around, we beat up the cars.
We only had one problem, and it was driver error, and that was my fault. I didn't put it in park, and we're in Bolivia. And the vehicle just kept, I mean, we had people in the back, we had cameras, and we rolled back because I didn't put it in park, and it hit a boulder, and it didn't hit it a little bit, it hit it properly. And I said, Brian, you're not going to believe this. The good news is we hit a boulder. He's like, what are you talking about? I was like, because if I didn't hit the boulder, it'd still be rolling. It literally would be rolling all the way back to Argentina. And so what's your version?
My version's the same, and it's amazing when you're out and you're trying to capture the content to tell the story, because it all comes together. As you all know, from an artistic perspective, you need that. And you need, on a trip like this, the relationships of people you're with and to be there for them. And so when David called and he said, I hit a boulder, we just said, okay, we'll come out. We'll get the truck back from you. And we were all together. We kept working on the cars. And what was amazing is every day, just made it better. We kept going. It's amazing when you're around people that show up to a problem with an attitude of, huh, that's interesting. And then you just solve it, right?
Yeah, I think one of the interesting things from my side was, you know, we had David wanting to create a little bit of drama, so his documentary was much more exciting. Yeah. We were trying to keep things on track, and, you know, those two worlds colliding was always an interesting recipe for...
I want to capture drama. Yeah. I didn't want to create. We didn't create it. No. Anyway, we're sitting here talking about it. The unique thing about this project, unlike most Hollywood productions, in fairness, is we do try to keep the team super small, and we never go back. So if we're in a village, we shoot it, and whatever we get, we get. So we're constantly on the move, and it was impossible for this thing to happen without you guys. And I'm sitting here trying to laugh, but these guys could have had an attitude. They could have said no. They could have said, they never said no. And we were on the road. I mean, we weren't making a big deal of it, because we know that there are people who do trickier things, people who drive emergency vehicles, people who teach children. But we're trying to make this film, and they were committed to it. They didn't answer to me. They answered to the dream. And thank you, guys. I want to say it publicly. Thank you, guys. Thank you, RJ.
So everything about courage, coming in and saying, and then I know from my side, it gets tough. Days get long. People get tired. But the opportunity, and RJ said this earlier, we want to build a vehicle that allows people to go and have that moment and capture that photo and that image. And I know I came back a different person, where you look at challenges in a different way on something like this. And it was such an adventure to be a part of, and having the opportunity to push yourself and to find out when it is easy to say no. And we could have said it from the beginning, hey, David, this is a great idea, but we have to focus on production. Good luck. We didn't. RJ didn't. And then when we said two cars, great. Charging infrastructure, great. Support vehicles, sure. Let's put solar panels on a roof of a car so we can charge off of them. Why not?
To chime in with you, like, the people were really excited at that point of time. Nobody knew how big of an adventure this was. It was like task, like, let's get it done. Let's get it, the car on the road again for the next day. And you would get only moments, like maybe 5 minutes a day, where you realize, hold it, what are we doing? Where are we? On what journey are we in?
Pete, how about you? Favorite thing that happened on the trip? What stands out?
Favorite thing, I think, all the different cultures we moved through, and the generosity from everyone all the way up. I don't think, like, yes, internally we work together really well, but I think the generosity of the general public as well, taking us in. I think you saw us working in underground of a garage there. That was a Harley Davidson dealership in the middle of Lima, and they were like family to us for a week while we're doing our internal work.
For a week, they fed us.
Yeah, every day.
And they fed us. They got us tools. So they were our local help. And that was like very heartwarming, and that they took care of us like, you know, like we were their children.
It is hope for all of us. And that's why it's keep the world adventurous forever. It's not about us, it's about this bigger place. And saying yes to some of these crazy ideas and taking the opportunity to have an adventure, we find out who we are when there is no script. There is no plan. There's no, here's what tomorrow is going to be. And I think for all of us, the opportunity to be a part of this, the opportunity to see this at Rivian, I mean, we talked about this with the space we're in. It's because of the people here that we're able to create these things. And we're just proud to be able to celebrate with all of you. So thanks for
sharing the story with us. Thank you, guys. Thank you, RJ.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.